Hello everyone, welcome to this live session. Can everyone hear my voice?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So in this today's session, we'll be discussing
Yes, sir.
Okay. So good evening everyone. In today's session we'll be discussing four of the doubts which has been asked on our exclusive WhatsApp group by the online course students. So we'll keep it limited to four doubts today. Many are still joining, but it's over 5 minutes since we have given time, so we won't be waiting much and we'll start with the question now. The question one that we'll take is from TMJ. So the question is asking that which of the following are the normal features in the temporomandibular joint, except. So the question is saying that all, here we have taken three options only. So out of this three, two are normal feature and one is abnormal. So which is it? So the third option that is given to us is deviation of the mouth in the opposite while opening the mouth in eccentric movements. So that is obvious. When you open in eccentric movements, it will lead to deviation. So the confusion is in between the joint sound and pain while opening the mouth. So in this case, what will be the answer? So the answer, we have taken reference from few of the textbooks in which we can see that whenever there is joint sound, the joint sound doesn't always mean an abnormality. Even a normal joint can have joint sound present. So this reference, one which you can see on your right side, which we are seeing here, it is taken from a textbook for TMJ disorders and occlusion, the name of which is Okeson. So from Okeson this is taken, and it is saying, okay, many are still joining us in the live session. Okay, so this we will not be allowing anyone in now because it breaks the link. Okay, so this reference is taken from Okeson, and the Okeson is saying that there was one study done, and this study showed that there are asymptomatic joint sounds which are very common, and this TMJ sounds are as such detected in 25 to 35% of the general population. These are the ones who are don't have any kind of disease or TMJ disorders. Still, the joint sounds are there. So in this, from this reference, we can say that even the joint sound is normal. So answer in this case will be pain while opening the mouth. That is, all of the following features in the TMJ are normal except. So in that case, what is abnormal is pain. Whenever there is pain in the joint, it is not normal. Now let's get back to this. So if all the sounds are not progressive and all the joint sounds, if they are not supposed to be treated, then which ones are actually abnormal and which ones require treatment? So how we will decide which to treat and which not to treat? So in this case, what Okeson says is that only the sounds which are associated with the pain should be treated. So there should be joint sound plus pain. In that too, the pain has to be specific. The pain has to be of intracapsular origin. It should be from the TMJ itself. In other words, the patient who reports with extracapsular pain, that is the pain which is from the muscles but not from the TMJ. If the pain appears to be of a muscular origin, plus there is a painless clicking joint in the TMJ, in that case, this condition is not a disc derangement disorder, and this should not be treated for the disc derangement as such. This condition should be treated for the pain which is of muscular origin. So this is, I guess it's clear to everyone that for this question as such, the answer will be pain, which is not a normal feature. And whenever there is pain in the patient's, let's say whenever there is clicking sound associated with the TMJ, in that case, we should check whether this condition is associated with the intracapsular condition or not. if it is associated with the intracapsular condition plus there is let's say TMJ pain, in that case we have to treat this. Otherwise we don't have to treat the clicking sound as such. We can treat the muscular origin. One more thing is about examining the joint sound. So what Okesan says that many times some clinician, they examine the joint sound by putting the fingers inside the patient's ear. Now if you put, this is known as intra-auricular palpation. Now in this case what happens, if you do this, what it will do, it will push the ear canal cartilage against the posterior aspect of the joint. And in this case, if it is pushing against the posterior, let's say this is patient's ear and here is the condyle. Now if you put your finger here in the ear, it will push the cartilage against the TMJ, and because it is being pushed against this condyle at this particular point, it will create the this joints even if they were not present. So this tissue will produce sounds, or this force will displace the disc which will produce the additional sounds. Okay, so this, whenever you are examining the TMJ, the palpation should always be done extra auricularly. That is what we do normally in front of the this pinna of the ear, and there we have to palpate it. So is this question clear to everyone? Can everyone hear me?
Yes sir, clear sir.
Okay, yeah, so next we'll move on to the next question, which is asking about the, it is from oral surgery. Yeah, someone has raised the hand. Anyone is having any doubt, or was it by mistake? So we have this option of raise hand. You use that whenever you have doubt. You have two options. Either you can unmute yourself and ask to me, and if you don't want to unmute yourself, you can just raise your hand. I'll ask you directly. Okay. Next, we'll move on to the next question. Now this question is asking about that in which of the following condition elevator can be used to advantage. Now again, someone has raised the hand. If you have doubt, you can ask now. Don't just check whether it is working or not. It is working. If you have doubt, you can ask. Otherwise, no need to raise that. Now, this question is from oral surgery, and it is asking that elevator can be used to advantage when. Now, four options are there. Now, this, remember, we have to know what is this question asking. This, of course, in all of the four conditions given below, you can use the elevator. But in which of the following cases, if you use elevator, it will give you extra advantage? The option is in the case when the tooth to be extracted is isolated. The second option is when the interdental bone is supposed to be used as fulcrum. Third option is when the adjacent tooth is not to be extracted. And fourth option is multiple adjacent teeth are to be extracted. Now in this case, we need to understand the concept of use of elevators. So whenever you are using elevators, remember this thing, the elevator should be held firmly with the palm, with the index finger resting on the working arm of the control, working arm to control the force. It has to be placed preferably on the mesial side of the tooth at angle of 45 degree to luxate it with the minimal force. And in this case, ideally you should take support, or you should take fulcrum from the interdental bone. You should never take support from the adjacent bone, otherwise it will cause luxation of that also. So if we see the options now, the first option is saying that the tooth to be extracted is isolated. Now in this case, actually this becomes even more difficult when you want to extract an isolated tooth with help of elevator, because you will not get enough fulcrum. Second option is use of interdental bone as fulcrum. Now obviously this is a case from where we are doing this normal extractions with help of the elevator, but it is not going to give you any extra advantage. Third option is the adjacent tooth is not to be extracted. It is actually same as option B only, where you are taking support from the this interdental bone as fulcrum, but the adjacent tooth should not be taken support of. So we are left with the fourth option, in which when there is multiple adjacent teeth are to be extracted. So in this case, what can be done is you can keep the elevator in between the two teeth, and then you can rotate it clockwise and anti-clockwise. By doing this, you'll luxate both of the teeth in the opposite direction, and then you can easily extract this teeth with help of your forceps. Now, this technique or this method has a name. Can anyone tell me what is the name of this method?
Staubes
method.
Yes, it is known as Staubes method. So that's why for this question that we have discussed, the answer will be D. That the multiple adjacent teeth, when they were supposed to be extracted, the elevator can be used to advantage. Now, if the question was that elevator can be used in which of the following, then all of the answer can be possible. But if the question is asking about when the teeth, when the elevator can be used to advantage, in that case, the answer will be multiple teeth being extracted. Okay, this is clear to everyone. The second question. Okay. Next, we'll move on to this question, which is from Prostho, and it is asking about the centric relation . Can everyone hear my voice? Hello, can everyone hear my voice?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, I guess in between there was some network error, so it had got disconnected. So this previous question is clear to everyone, no? The question with the Staubes method. Okay. Now we are moving on to the next question, which is from Prostho, and it is asking about the position of condyles in the case of centric relation. Now remember this question, I guess it is from Pulse, and it was asked in 98. And since 98, or even maybe before that, starting from that time and till now, the definition of centric relation has been changing. The latest definition, which is given by the Glossary of Prosthodontic Terms, GPT 9 in 2017, this defines the centric relation as a condition or the position in which which is independent of the tooth contact and the condyle articulate with the glenoid fossa in the anterosuperior position against the posterior slope of the articular eminence. So if we see here, if this is the articular eminence, against the posterior slope of the articular eminence, the condyle is articulating with the anterosuperior position. So maybe if you see the previous definitions, some book had told as the posterior most position, some books had told as posterior superior position, anterior most position, all of these options have been given in past, but the latest definition, which is by GPT 9, which we are following, according to that, the answer will be C, which is thus in the centric relation, the condyle will be positioned in the anterosuperior position. So is it clear to everyone? You can unmute your audio in between and you can answer.
Sir. Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Next question we are taking from General Medicine. Now this doubt is asking about the Brown-Siegward syndrome. And it is saying that which of the sensation is not lost in Brown-Siegward syndrome. And the most important point to remember in this is it is not lost on the side of lesion. If you see the description of this Brown-Siegward syndrome, all these four kind of sensation, that is touch, muscle sense or the joint sense, vibration sense and temperature, all of these are lost. So first, let's see the Brown-Sequard syndrome. The Brown-Sequard syndrome is actually a functional cord hemisection which is dissociated with the sensory loss. Now, one of the cord is damaged. Let's say this is the damaged part of the cord. So in the pure Brown-Sequard syndrome, what will happen? On the side which is affected, that is this side which is affected, there will be loss of motor function, vibration, position, deep touch, sensation. All of this will be lost on the side where there is damage. So on the side which is damaged, you'll have, that is the ipsilateral, motor function will be impaired, which includes light touch, joint position sense and vibration. There will also be loss of sensation on the opposite side. On the opposite side, the sensation being lost are pain and temperature, which is impaired. So if we see in the question, all the touch, muscle sense, vibration sense and temperature are being affected. But if you have to choose answer based on the important point in the question, that is, which of the following is not lost on the side of lesion, in that case, we can easily choose the answer as D, which is temperature. So is this clear to everyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
So, yes, sir.
Okay. So, for today's session, we are having just these four questions. We'll come up with one more live session maybe tomorrow or maybe day after tomorrow, in which we'll be.
Thanks for watching the video. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel for more updates.